Hey guys.
Hi. So what's the overall theme of the new season?
Ooh, we're jumping right in with themes.
Yes.
Well, when we were talking at the beginning of the season, we talked about things around the idea of, like, you can't go home again. The kids are grown up. They're not looking back. They're not thinking about maybe we should go back with our parents. Or maybe there's a way that we can put the world together back how it was. That's over. They're moving forward, and they're dealing with issues that really are grown-up issues this year.
We've also always talked about this idea of every kid grows up to be like their parents. Mm-hmm. And if your parents are evil, you know, that's a challenge for you as a kid. So these guys are all going to be wrestling with Nico most overtly, some of these forces and powers that they're coming into, perhaps being corrupting or perhaps taking you to a dark, you know, to the dark side. So I think those are all kind of, there's all those themes of Adolfo.
It's very something wicked this way comes. It has that kind of feeling about it. And with Elizabeth Hurley joining the cast as Morgan Le Fay, you literally have something wicked coming. It's kind of extraordinary.
Mm-hmm. How was it bringing Cloak and Dagger into the story? Were there any challenges, or did it flow organically?
It flowed really well. I mean, we've been talking about it for a while. We've actually been asking Jeph if we could do it since day one. And then finally, the storyline.
The first I've heard of it.
Literally, like, ringing his doorbell this year. But
I gave him candy. Said, come on.
It wasn't even Halloween. But we had a storyline in terms, again, of what Nico's journey was going on that synced up with some of the stuff that Cloak has been wrestling with, and with a lot of conversation with Marvel, and Joe Bukowski's the showrunner of Cloak and Dagger, and it made a lot of sense, and they were thrilled to get to shoot in Los Angeles. So that was very easy. And there's only two of them, and we have a giant mansion, so there's plenty of room.
How did you decide to go with Magic this season after the first two seasons of kind of a tech-based wizardry?
We earned it, I think.
Yeah, I mean, Magic is a little more heightened than the tech-based things, even though magic is just science
that you don't understand. So that's just tech.
I really don't understand this magic.
But wanting to get there and really earn it and feel like we could do it in a way that was grounded. But to do it, because in the DNA of the show, you have aliens, time travel, magic, dinosaurs, and wanting to be able to do that this season and kind of have fun with those different, mixing up those different genres.
Yeah, the show started, it was almost, you could go whole episodes with very little power sort of on display and these kids coming into it, and every season we've kind of upped the ante, and this year's easily the biggest one yet.
How does that impact, like, bringing Cloak and Dagger in? Because, you know, I was asking, like, do they meet the dinosaur? You know, like, that's some...
We wanted to do all that fun stuff. Yeah, because it's the idea, they didn't know. Our kids don't know that there's any other kids out there like them, and either the Cloak and Dagger. So it's that first encounter of, like, wait, there's other kids like us, and you guys have a dinosaur? So we definitely want to make sure that they get to have the experience any fan would have walking into the hostel and meeting all those, you know.
And that was important for us at Marvel Television, which is that we don't do this often, and we don't, particularly with the kids, play it very publicly. There's nobody that's mm-hmm. stepping out in front of a camera saying, I am Iron Man. And so the idea of them running into each other really became something that we could have a lot of fun with, in the sense that, again, that every kid at some point feels like, I'm the only one who feels like this. And being able to take that and use that as sort of the body of how these six kids and then these two other kids now suddenly realize, oh, we're not that different. And then that opens the door for us to be able to ask the question, which is, who else is there out there that might be like us? Do they need our help, or are they doing it just fine, and do we need to learn from them?
And they're not sort of willing participants at first. I mean, at first Nico and Dagger don't see eye to eye on some of these things. A little friction in the group at first. It's pretty fun.
Can you tease any new dynamics among the group in the upcoming season?
Sure.
I think everything that's happening to Nico in terms of discovering her power and how her power might be linked to a certain darkness really complicates her relationship with Carolina.
Zavin and Molly have a really nice dynamic where Zavin is this warrior and Molly wants to be this vigilante, and so, but she can't control her emotions, and Zavin is this sort of emotionless warrior, and so they have a really nice kind of like sisterly relationship, which is special. I think also some of the relationships between our kids and our parents changed this year and evolved this year, and And when Morgan Le Fay, you know, when someone like Morgan Le Fay is out there, sometimes even if you don't like your parents, you need your parents, you know? And so that also becomes a dynamic that kind of upends the relationships.
But one of the things we talked about at the beginning of the season was, because after you've done 23 before. You sort of realize, oh, those actors have worked together, or those characters have been in scenes. How can we now find pair-ups that we haven't seen before? And that was a lot of fun, was being able to, like, actors suddenly realizing, oh, I mean, I've been in a scene where, like, everybody's in, but we've never had a one-on-one together. And so that gave the writers, I think, the freedom to be able to go, okay, what would those two people be like if they had to, at best, tolerate each other, or be drawn to each other, which is the fun.
The past seasons, we've seen some Provo Easter eggs. Can you tease? Will we see any more of them? Is he on the lookout for, maybe?
For Easter eggs?
Yeah.
Well, I mean, the finale, there's a couple of Easter eggs, but we can't really talk about that, especially with this guy at the table, but find me later, I'll tell you everything. This year, the Easter eggs have hatched, and Cloak and Dagger have appeared. So that last year, that was an egg. Now it's a little chickadee.
How do you assess the tone of this coming season? Like, is it darker overall? Yeah. What are you doing?
Yeah, I mean, we still love having, yeah, obviously, the emotion and humor and romance and all that, all those core kind of relationship stories are at the core, but it's definitely the darkest season. Not everybody makes it out of the season alive. So, yeah, I would definitely
say. It's the Winter Soldier of
Runaways. Wow. That's your headline, awesome. Right there. Mic drop.